OK, the final item of business this evening is a member's business debate on motion 13937 in the name of Jackson Carlaw on 40th anniversary of the Brighton bomb blast. The debate will be concluded without any questions being put. I'd invite members wishing to participate to press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible, and I invite Jackson Carlaw to open the debate around 7 minutes. Mr Carlaw.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and can I move the motion in my name and thank those colleagues who've chosen to support it. There are some events that you are party to that you never forget. And as somebody who was at Brighton the night that bomb exploded, this is one for me. It's not something I've talked about publicly very much, but as I myself get older, I felt maybe now was a time to put my experience of that night into the record and my reflections of what it meant for politics in this country, all the way through to Joe Cox, to David Amos, and to colleagues in this chamber who I know, not always publicly but privately, have been subject to real harassment and concern. But let me start 10 years before the events of 1984 in 1974, because it's important to put into context the issue of the Troubles in Northern Ireland, which underpinned all of the difficulties that we saw in the United Kingdom at that time, and to an event that the 50th anniversary of took place last weekend, of a bomb that blew up in Guildford in the Horse and Groom pub, because amongst the victims that night were two young boys aged 17 and 18 in the Scots Guards who lived in Barhead in East Renfrewshire. They lived in the same street at number 18 and number 11. They'd been in the Boys' Brigade together. They'd been in the same school football team. They'd worked in Armitage Shanks together. They had a joint funeral, and they lie together in the cemetery adjacent to one another to this day. Troubles of that era came very close to home in many communities here in Scotland with people who were serving in the armed forces, but for two young boys, hardly out of school, who'd joined the army, to be cut down in that way, was something that I think had a great effect on my local community. 10 years later, I was at my sixth party conference, and we all here have been at our own respective party conferences. They were very open affairs. Yes, there was a certain amount of policing at them, but it was more really to marshal demonstrators. It wasn't really policing that in any sense was concerned that there was a genuine threat to life. On that day, on October the 12th, commemorated this Saturday, I was in the bar of the Grand Hotel until about 1 o'clock. I then went back to my digs with other people. And in a way I've never been properly able to explain, I woke up suddenly with a very deep-seated sense of unease that something wasn't right. And I couldn't put any finger on what it was, but I just felt it. And I said to the people that we were sharing accommodation with, look, something's not right. Let's get up and go and see. And we did. We were 100 yards away from the Grand Hotel. And we walked round, and there before us was an extraordinary sight. It reminded me, I think, the only parallel at the time I could think of was the disaster in Clarkston that had taken place earlier in the 1970s, when a landmark that you were familiar with was suddenly ripped apart in front of you. And there it was, the Grand Hotel, with this gaping sash down it. And we did what we could. We brought deck chairs up from the beach to help people just to sit down who were sort of staggering out, covered in soot and dust. But in due course, you kind of realised that that was as much as you could do and that the emergency services had to be left to get on with things. We knew that the Prime Minister had survived, but in an age before digital communications, it was very difficult to know anything else that was going on whatsoever. What we understood, though, was that there had been an attempt to wipe out the democratically elected government of the United Kingdom, and it didn't matter of which political party or whether they were fans, let's face it, not many other political parties were, of Margaret Thatcher. They all stood together and understood at that moment that this was an act of terror, the like of which we'd not seen in this country before. Had it been successful, would have had profound implications, and even unsuccessfully had profound implications. The bomb was behind the bath panel in room 629. And that was the room that was occupied by my friend Donald MacLean and his wife Muriel, the president of the Scottish Conservative and Unionist Association. I'd seen Muriel just two nights before. She was hosting the Scottish reception. I remember her still with the MacLean sash. She was a lovely woman. They were catapulted six floors down. Muriel died a few weeks later from the injuries she sustained, along with four other people. Donald was horribly scarred. For the rest of his life, he carried the injuries that he suffered that night with tremendous fortitude and courage. But what I do remember, even then, was that sense of leadership, irrespective of the politics, that the Prime Minister showed the following day. I remember journalists saying to me, she put the spine back into us as well, because everybody was shaken by the enormity of that event. But it led to a change in our politics. Until then, you could go to party conferences, politicians mixed and mingled. There was no real security. But from that moment onwards, and I recognised it from conferences I attended afterwards, a curtain had come down on the way politicians could engage at the most senior level. And over the years since, that has come to affect all of us too. For Joe Cox to be cut down in 2016, for David Amos to be cut down just a few years later, for members of this Parliament going about their daily business to have constituency offices, and I know there are colleagues here who've had constituency offices attacked, and I can say tonight that last week a woman came to attack my office. She attacked the staff in the shared services area of the building. She was arrested by the police. She was on remand for three nights and has been charged. These things, I think, visit all of us and have changed the colour and character of politics. They've made it something we all have to be aware of that we never thought we would ever have to be aware of. And that is the long shadow that I think has carried forward from that night in Brighton all those years ago. There's one positive thing I remember. On the 25th anniversary of that bomb, the fireman who had dug Donald MacLean out of the rubble contacted me and asked if I could put him in touch with Donald. They'd never met since that night. They were able to meet. I think it meant a great deal to Donald, who passed away the following year. Humanity finds its way through, even in these most awful of circumstances and tragedies. And that's what I choose to think and celebrate. That night gave me a determination that terrorism must never be allowed to succeed. That doesn't mean we can't confront the issues, the giant issues that trouble us. But when it comes down to it, we have to stand together as politicians and recognise that democracy is a fragile thing, and it will only succeed if we stand together and we work together and we are resolute.
Thank you. We move to the open debate. I call first Fulton McGregor to be followed by Edward Mount in around 4 minutes. Mr. McGregor.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I just say before I start, pay tribute to Jackson Carlow for what was a very powerful speech there, and talking about his own recollection of those times. And although there are many differences amongst us in this chamber, of all parties, one thing that I am completely confident in is that we are all united in our belief that democracy should be peaceful and have peaceful politics. This weekend will, of course, mark the 40th anniversary of an attempt to disrupt our democratic system and inject political violence and terrorism into our civic lives. Disagreement and debate are part of a healthy democracy. Planting bombs in hotels to target political leaders is not. Anthony Berry MP, Lady Jean Shattuck, Muriel MacLean, as has been mentioned, Eric Taylor, Roberta Wakeham. These are the five individuals who lost their lives that night. And whilst it is right that we remember those who died, as Jackson Carlow has already said, we must also remember those who were injured. Most famously, Margaret Tebbit, wife of Norman, who spent the rest of her life in a wheelchair, but more than 30 others who were also treated for varying injuries as a result of the blast. So many lives were affected by a grotesque attempt to disrupt our political system. And I think it's only fair that we must also pay special tribute to the members of Sussex Police and East Sussex Fire Brigade, who were the first on the scene. The heroic action saved many lives, as did the work of all emergency services who were present that night. And I do commend the resilience that those who experienced the attack, like Jackson Carlow, displayed by continuing the party conference mere hours after the attack took place. And this is backed up by Garrett Fitzgerald, the Irish PM at the time, who summed up the attack by referring to it as, I quote, a gross miscalculation of the character of the British people and the nature of British democracy. And on that point, Presiding Officer, it is important to underline that the attack cannot be seen as a reflection on the Irish community in the UK either. Attacks like this can often increase inter-community tensions, and inflammatory articles such as the Sunday Express's statement that "wouldn't you rather admit to being a pig than being Irish" did nothing to mend these relations, and acknowledge that the IRA's actions horrified the majority of the Irish community. The IRA do not represent the views of the Irish community any more than any terrorist group represents the views of other people. And this is, of course, important to me as a member for Coatbridge and Crison, who have a large Irish community who have often faced discrimination over the years. And I know that the Irish community in Coatbridge at that time completely condemned this horrific attack. In looking at the legacy of the attack, we must also realise that today there will be many people across Scotland and indeed the wider UK who will be too young to recall the political violence associated with Northern Ireland throughout the Troubles. The fact that we have more and more generations who have not had to live through these violent times is something that we cannot take for granted. On that October night 40 years ago, few would have believed that within 15 years an extensive peace process would have led to the groundbreaking terms of the Good Friday Agreement. This mammoth agreement required mutual trust, cooperation and a sincere belief in renouncing violence and investing in a better future for all. There are lessons we can learn from that today. It is understandable to look at the situations unfolding in the Middle East, Ukraine and Sudan and think that there is no hope. We all must feel that sometimes. But history has shown that with determined efforts, peace can be achieved. This is held true in Northern Ireland, as well as other regions, which have seen years of political violence, such as Colombia and South Africa. So, Presiding Officer, I'll close by once again unequivocally condemning the attack, asserting that violence has no place in our democratic system. And I join in the sentiment of Jackson Carlow and all colleagues who will speak tonight, who have expressed their condolences for those who were affected, injured and killed 40 years ago. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call Edward Mountain to be followed by Tim Eagle, around 4 minutes. Mr Mountain.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to thank Jackson Carlow for speaking today on a personal event which I think shook us all in 1984. For me, it was the culmination of a long line of IRA atrocities. As he said, it euphemistically came and was termed as the Troubles, but it was more than that. Because what we need to remember that in the build-up to that, terrorism for the IRA was the threat of action designed to influence the government by intimidating the public. And that's what happened on that day. For me, it happened probably 2 years earlier, and some months earlier than that, two years and I think 3 months earlier, when the Hyde Park bombing happened to my regiment. To remind those members that don't know about it, a bomb was made by Danny McNamee and planted in a blue Morris Marina on the south carriageway of Hyde Park. And John Downey sat on a bench about 300 metres from where the car was parked and waited till the horses rode past and waited for the most opportune moment to explode it, killing Anthony Daly, Roy Bright, Geoffrey Young, and Simon Tipper, and seven horses. I'm not sure what possessed him to think that blowing up people in ceremonial armour was ever going to take his argument further forward. But it was a calculated decision, in the same way that the Brighton bombing was a calculated decision. The bomb planted much earlier and planned to go off in the middle of the night to cause maximum devastation. And I think Patrick McNamee, who planted the bomb, said afterwards, when he talked to the families, that having listened to them, he could never do it again. And I think that's a message for all terrorists. You will never achieve what you want to do by intimidating the public. And listen to those people who tried. And please don't ever do it again. That's my one message. It's not right to attack unarmed people and try and subvert democracy, especially in the United Kingdom. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. I now call Tim Eagle to be followed by Paul O'Kane. Around 4 minutes, Mr. Eagle.
Sorry, Presiding Officer. Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm honoured to speak today in support of my colleague Jackson Carlow's motion on...
Can we have Mr. Eagle's microphone, please?
Sorry. My bad. I'm not prepared, Presiding Officer, today, am I? Whilst I have very few memories of the bombing myself, being only four at the time, I have many friends and family who live in the South East, and I can remember visiting Brighton as a child. Whilst my preschool mind, I'm sure, was fixated on the donuts and rinds of Brighton Pier, I can recall my grandparents speaking and pointing about the hotel every time we passed. It's amazing how when I heard that Jackson Carlow had put forward this debate, the feelings, thoughts and memories of my parents and my grandparents talking about this in the past came rushing back to me. We should never forget that events like this and the many others that we have sadly seen in the UK leave lasting memories, injuries and suffering. As others have mentioned, 34 people were injured in the terrorist attack by the IRA, many with life-changing injuries. That included Lord and Lady Tebbit, which have been mentioned already. Lady Tebbit was in hospital for 2 years following the bomb, and her injuries meant she was severely paralysed for the rest of her life. Lord Tebbit recovered in hospital for 3 months and subsequently gave up his parliamentary seat in 1992 to care for his wife. Lady Tebbit was remarkable. When recording Desert Island Discs with Sue Lawley in 1995, she said that she didn't blame people. I don't completely forgive or forget, but one has to completely look forward, she remarked. She described how recovering the spinal unit, she felt lucky, as there were always people so much worse off than her, that at least she was 50, and she was so grateful that she could still simply communicate. Sue Lawley said that Lady Tebbit shows no trace of bitterness, simply an acute eye for the needs of those who, like her, become the victims of sudden, terrible injuries. Lady Tebbit died in 2020. Lord Tebbit is now 93, and I pay tribute to them both. While preparing for this debate and rereading the details of the immediate aftermath of the bomb in the Grand Hotel, I was shocked to learn just how close the Prime Minister, Margaret Thatcher, had been to being injured or killed herself in the blast. It is extraordinary that the Prime Minister, her husband and private secretary were unhurt, and it was equally extraordinary that the conference went as planned ahead that day, as Jackson Carlow has already said. As the Prime Minister said in her conference speech that afternoon, the fact that we are gathered here now, shocked but composed and determined, is a sign not only that this attack has failed, but that all attempts to destroy democracy by terrorism will fail. Equally extraordinary is that the Prime Minister continued with the ongoing talks with the Irish government, as she must have been deeply and personally impacted by the attacks, deaths and injuries. I wholeheartedly support my colleague Jackson Carlow's belief, as set out in his motion, that engaging in murderous terrorist activity to achieve political ends is completely unacceptable, and that terrorist attacks to weaken our system of democracy must always fail and never be allowed to succeed. So I would like to quote the powerful and eloquent response to the Brighton bomb attack given by Labour MP Gerald Cuffman in the House of Commons on the 22nd of October 1984. He said, "Let us be quite clear about what happened at the Grand Hotel in Brighton on the 12th of October. This was no random act of violence. It cannot be compared, and it should not be compared with any other act of violence, great or small. That takes place within our society. This was a deliberate attempt to destroy a government by mass murder. Yes, that government are a Conservative government with whom we have the most serious differences. But they are a democratically elected government. They are the British government. Let it be said in the plainest terms that the only way that we get rid of a government in Britain is by the ballot box. Terrorism and assassination have no place whatsoever in the political processes in this country. We utterly and unanimously reject them, and we shall fight with every fibre of our being against them. Presiding Officer, I thank my colleague Jackson Carlow for bringing this important debate to the Parliament and his powerful message today. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call Paul O'Kane to be followed by Murdo Fraser around 4 minutes. Mr O'Kane.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I begin by respectfully acknowledging Jackson Carlow bringing this motion to Parliament for debate this evening. And for him and indeed for Conservative colleagues, I appreciate this is a very emotive subject, given the personal connections many had to the victims of the bombing, but also the long-standing connections to their families and indeed to those who survived that terrible night. And we debate this anniversary, of course, as the current party conference season has just concluded, and it has caused me to reflect, having attended my own party's gathering in Liverpool just weeks ago, on the magnitude and the horror of what happened 40 years ago in Brighton. And that has been recounted by Jackson Carlow this evening in a very personal and a very powerful way, and I commend him for that speech this evening. I have often reflected, and I often reflect, that political parties become like something of an extended family, the good, the bad, the in-between, of course. So it is hard to imagine those we come to care about so deeply being killed or being harmed in such circumstances. And party conferences are part of the lifeblood of our democratic traditions. So when terrorism strikes at the heart of our democracy in such a direct way and claims innocent lives, it must be condemned. And I think this evening, across this chamber, we stand united in that condemnation. Now, many in this chamber will know that the troubles in Northern Ireland and the long road to peace are very personal to me and to my family. And tonight, we remember victims of that conflict, thousands killed across these islands, many just innocent bystanders living their lives every single day. And every corner was touched by those dark days. My own family in County Derry and County Tyrone, the soldiers that are etched on the war memorials in towns and villages like the one I live in today. And I join Jackson Carlow in reflecting on that other anniversary that we have commemorated in the past week, the 50th anniversary of John Hunter and Billy Forsyth from Barhead, who were killed in the Guildford bombings just aged 17 and 18 on their first deployment to the army, and just young, innocent men who were on a night out. There was, of course, the pain of the miscarriage of justice and the search for answers that followed. And the pain, I think, is an important point to reflect on this evening, pain that is unimaginable, and I know that so many people carry still today. Decades ago, it was unimaginable that an end to the darkness was possible. But today, the light of peace shines across Northern Ireland. There are, as we have heard from other speakers, adults in their mid-20s who have known nothing else. And peace, of course, can be fragile. It can be confusing. It requires compromises that can feel impossible to make. But for those young people, it must endure and succeed. And tonight, we should in this chamber remember those people who made it possible. The forbearance of John Hume, the groundwork laid by John Major in the most difficult of circumstances, and the empathy of Mo Molum in delivering the Good Friday Agreement. And of course, the next step on that journey is reconciliation. Again, that is a hard road to embark upon, and I know it is difficult for many to contemplate. But I'm sure there are many who will also agree the examples that have been set in the work of people like Jo Berry, the daughter of Sir Anthony Berry, who died in the blast, and Pat McGee, who planted the bomb, is an important starting point. Deputy Presiding Officer, perhaps I can leave the chamber this evening with the words of the late Queen on her historic visit to Ireland. These events have touched us all, many of us personally, and are a painful legacy. We can never forget those who have died or been injured and their families. To all those who have suffered as a consequence of our troubled past, I extend my sincere thoughts and deep sympathy. With the benefit of historical hindsight, we can all see things which we wish had been done differently or not at all. But it is also true that no one who looked to the future over the past centuries could have imagined the strength of bonds that are now in place between the governments and the people of our two nations, the spirit of partnership that we now enjoy, and the lasting rapport between us. My condolences to those still living in pain and with loss, and I offer my hope for an ongoing commitment to peace, democracy and reconciliation across these islands. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call Murdo Fraser to be followed by Christine Graham. Around 4 minutes, Mr Fraser.
Thank you. Presiding Officer, can I commend my friend Jackson Carlow for securing this debate on this very important anniversary and congratulate him on his very moving contribution earlier in the debate. And indeed, all members who have spoken in this debate have made very fine contributions. I was not, unlike Jackson Carlow, present at the Grand Hotel in 1984. I was at that stage far too young to be allowed out on my own. I wasn't even a member of the Conservative Party at that stage. But I do remember that date well, and I still remember the television pictures that were broadcast from the events of that night and the anguished face of a pyjama-clad Norman Tebbit being carried on a stretcher from the ruins. And as we've already heard, it was Margaret Tebbit who suffered more than he did. Margaret Tebbit fell through four floors and ended up paralysed from the chest down, having to spend the rest of her life in a wheelchair, something which probably contributed to a premature end to Norman Tebbit's political career, although I'm pleased to say he is still with us. There were five individuals who died that night, as we've heard: Sir Anthony Berry, Roberta Wakeham, Jennifer Taylor, Lady Shattuck, who was decapitated instantly following the blast, and of course Muriel and MacLean, who Jackson Carlow had the privilege of knowing, the wife of Donald MacLean. And I never met Muriel MacLean, but I met Sir Donald, as he became, on a number of occasions subsequently. The target of the attack was the Prime Minister, Margaret Thatcher, who survived, but it was a close-run thing because the bathroom of the room that she shared with Dennis Thatcher was destroyed. And had she been in the bathroom at the time of the blast, almost certainly she would have been very badly injured, if not killed herself, which of course was the intention of the IRA bombers. So it was an extremely close-run thing. The following morning, Margaret Thatcher attended the Conservative Party conference and received an instant standing ovation. And she made a very brave and famous speech that afternoon, concluding with these words: "All attempts to destroy democracy by terrorism will fail." And you don't need to be a fan of Margaret Thatcher or even a Conservative to agree with that sentiment. There is perhaps a certain symmetry that we are holding this debate and recognising this anniversary just a couple of days after the first anniversary of the horrific terror attack on Israel by Hamas, Israel being the only fully functioning democracy in the Middle East. And whether it is the IRA or Hamas or Hezbollah or any other terrorist organisation, I think we should be very clear that terrorism must always be confronted and not allowed to succeed. And as we reflect on the memory and the sacrifice of those who were killed in the Brighton bombing 40 years ago, we should all hold fast to that principle and resolve that democracy must prevail. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call Christine Graham to be followed by Stephen Kerr. Around 4 minutes, Ms Graham.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I thank my colleague Jackson Carlow for bringing this debate and his moving personal recollection. I well remember the bombing and the sight I recall of Sir Norman Tebbit, then grey with dust, being carried out in a stretcher. It's an image those of us around at the time cannot erase. It symbolised the horror of that day. Now, I had and have little regard for Margaret Thatcher as a political leader whose bombastic approach to politics at a domestic and international level for me was confrontational by choice and I regard often destructive. But I was horrified by the bomb attack directed at her, which killed others and injured the many. Just like Jackson Carlow, I'll put it into context, if I may. I recall when the troubles resurfaced in Northern Ireland as I just married and moved to Galloway. It was 1969. I recall when the British troops went in. First, they were offered cups of tea, but that soon turned to resentment from half the Belfast population. Even then, I wondered how the troops would leave and when. Moving in was the easy part. Not having an exit strategy is a continuing error of successive UK governments. I recall farming families relocating to Galloway from the Irish border to remove themselves from being in the firing line, and saddened that neighbour could no longer trust neighbour. Catholics and Protestants that had lived side by side were now taking sides. So the decades came and went. We received then Ulster TV, so almost every night there were announcements of incendiary devices, often on the Armagh Road. So I was more aware of the realities of the divisions in Northern Ireland than perhaps other parts of the UK. In March 1979, Éirí Níomh, the then Shadow Secretary of State for Northern Ireland, was assassinated by the Irish National Liberation Army in a car bomb attack in the Palace of Westminster. He was a friend and political mentor to Margaret Thatcher. On 27 August 1979, less than 4 months after Margaret Thatcher became Prime Minister, Lord Mountbatten was killed by a bomb on his fishing boat off the coast of Mullaghmore, County Sligo, in the Irish Republic. The device had been planted by the Provisional Irish Republican Army, the IRA. On the same day, the IRA also killed 18 British soldiers near Warren Point with two bombs, the highest loss of life suffered in a single incident by the British Army during the Troubles. Northern Ireland was a war zone. Extremism thrived. In March 1981, Bobby Sands, an IRA member who was imprisoned at the Mays Prison, Northern Ireland, went on hunger strike for the return of special category status to prisoners. This meant treating those prisoners with the status of political prisoners rather than as criminals. It included not having to wear a prison uniform and being able to freely associate with other prisoners. While on hunger strike, he stood in the Fermanagh and South Tyrone by-election and won. At that time, Margaret Thatcher said, quote, "There can be no question of political status for someone who is serving a sentence for crime. Crime is crime is crime. It is not political, it is crime, and there can be no question of granting political status," close quote. 10 men died of starvation before the strike came to an end. Sands was the first to die, which he did 5 May 1981, after 66 days of starvation. His death led to rioting in Republican areas of Northern Ireland. I refer to these events not to make value judgments, but to place the attempted assassination of Margaret Thatcher and her cabinet in the context of that dreadful time. That said, there were wrongs, there were cruelties on all sides, and an abject failure of politics, which, as ever, even today in Israel, Gaza and Lebanon, means death and injury, with ordinary people caught in the middle. And in the end, as in Ireland, after all the bloodshed, compromise and a political solution, in this instance, the Good Friday Agreement. That is why, as politicians, while we deplore the use of the bullet rather than the ballot box, we must ensure engagement with democracy does not falter through our actions, or perhaps even more crucially, our inactions. That said, we must, without fear or favour, condemn violence whenever, but in today's context, towards politicians, whether you agree with their views or not, indeed more so if you disagree. Indeed, if the assassination of Margaret Thatcher had succeeded, it would not, in my view, have resolved the Troubles, but it would have succeeded in undermining our democracy. Today, politicians here operate, as others have said, in a culture where they're seen by some as fair game, even to the point of threats, violence and worse. What the events of that early morning in Brighton remind us is that democracy is vulnerable, fragile, has its dangers, but these are far outweighed by its freedoms, which we must all always protect. I thank Jackson Carlow for this debate and reminding me of those difficult days and how far Northern Ireland has come, and if, and it's an if, it is to be a united Ireland, it will be through the ballot box, not the bomb or the bullet. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call Stephen Kerr, around 4 minutes, Mr Kerr.
Presiding Officer, can I thank Jackson Carlow for a powerful and memorable speech, probably the best speech that I've ever heard delivered in this chamber as a member. Now, I've been a member of the Conservative Party since I was 15,
You develop a strange emotional attachment to the party that you belong to for nearly 50 years. And in and out of government, our party has had its finest and not so finest moments. And that's politics. But what happened in the early hours of the 12th of October 1984 wasn't politics. It was the attempted mass murder of ordinary members of the Conservative Party and a terrorist attack aimed at killing the Prime Minister and the Cabinet. It was a shocking assault on people, people like us, people like those of us who attended the Conservative Party conference last week in Birmingham. Now, I wasn't at the 1984 conference. My first Conservative Party conference was in 1977, but I wasn't at the 1984 conference because Yvonne and I were new parents, and I was still a student at Stirling University. But that morning, we watched breakfast TV, transfixed at the horror that was before us. Breakfast TV in 1984 was still a new thing, and they were on air providing us live pictures of the rescue of the survivors from the bombed building. As has been said, the front of the Grand Hotel had been blown completely away, and among the ruins we watched on television and has been referenced, Norman Tebbit being carefully extracted from the wreckage. Fred Bishop, the fire station officer on duty that night, was handling the slow descent of Norman Tebbit's stretcher. Famously, Norman Tebbit cried out at one point, "Get off my bloody feet, Fred." But Fred Bishop, a man of uncommon character, chatted with Tebbit about flying in the midst of all of this. Tebbit had been a pilot. He'd also been an official of BALPA. And he and, as Fred and the others tried to bring Tebbit down the floors of the hotel, there was an imminent risk of collapse. Tebbit wasn't told and didn't know how gravely his wife had been injured. Now, we already knew, particularly those of us who were active Conservatives, about Margaret Thatcher's formidable courage and conviction. I believe she's a historic figure for all times. She was asked live on TV by the BBC political editor John Cole if the conference would go ahead, and she swiveled around. And facing John Cole, she spoke slowly and deliberately and said, "The conference will go on as usual." And as if to make her point, she repeated it, "John, the conference will go on as usual." And there have been references already in this debate to what she said later that day in her conference speech. The wreckage of the nearby Grand Hotel still smouldering, the dead and injured still being identified and tended to. And I conclude, if I may, with an extended quote from what she said. "The bomb attack on the Grand Hotel early this morning was first and foremost an inhuman, undiscriminating attempt to massacre innocent, unsuspecting men and women staying in Brighton for our Conservative conference. Our first thoughts must be at once for those who died and for those who are now in hospital recovering from their injuries. But the bomb attack clearly signified more than this. It was an attempt not only to disrupt and terminate our conference, it was an attempt to cripple Her Majesty's democratically elected government. That is the scale of the outrage in which we have all shared. And the fact that we are gathered here now, shocked but composed and determined, is a sign not only that this attack has failed, but all attempts to destroy democracy by terrorism will fail." Deputy Presiding Officer, the lesson of Brighton to those of evil intent, those who trade in horror and the work of death for their own ends, is simply put, all attempts to destroy democracy by terrorism will fail. Our resolve must remain to that end.
Thank you. I now call on Jamie Hepburn to respond to the debate. Minister, for around about 7 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, President Officer. Can I also share my gratitude to Jackson Carlow for bringing forward his motion to be debated this evening in recognition of the 40-year anniversary of the bombing at the Grand Hotel in Brighton on the 12th of October 1984. Can I begin by commending him for speaking about an event that, for most of us, of course, is a public event, a profoundly important public event, but in the manner in which he addressed us this evening, he reminded us that for many, many people, it is also not just a public event, but a profoundly and deeply personal event too, and I was very, very moved by his contribution. President Officer, it is hard to find words that are adequate to respond to the enormity of the circumstances and the awful senselessness of violence that that event on the 12th of October 1984 represents. But it is, nonetheless, an opportunity today to put on record our collective condolences to all of the family of those victims, those killed, those injured, and those affected by the bombing, one of the Provisional Irish Republican Army's most significant attacks on mainland Britain. I cannot begin to imagine, and frankly, I hope never to have to begin to imagine, the depth of the loss for those impacted by any such sudden violent loss. Violence is a means to achieve political ends, no matter what they may be, is intolerable in any free society, and it is right that we mark this anniversary. Sadly, it is not the only incident where we have seen violence inflicted against those involved in the political process in these islands in the last 40 years. We are, of course, grateful that in regards to what has been known as the Troubles, a period that has had its own impact in different ways here in Scotland, a fragile peace was struck in Northern Ireland with the Good Friday Agreement in 1998, and we are further grateful that peace holds still to this day. But today's debate allows us to recognise and remember other fellow politicians who have lost their lives while carrying out their public duties, whilst listening to and whilst representing the people they were elected to serve, an honour and a sacred duty at the heart of our democracy. Ian Gow, MP, killed by a car bomb placed under his vehicle outside his home on the 30th of July 1990. Joe Cox, MP, shot and stabbed and killed just as she was about to hold her constituency surgery on the 16th of June 2016. David Amos, MP, stabbed and killed, was actually in his constituency surgery on the 15th of October 2021. As a means of honouring those who have lost their lives, it is essential that we must not allow acts of terrorism, whatever end they may be motivated by, to succeed in undermining democracy. Terrorism can never be accepted, and we must challenge it together with methods that do not compromise our respect for the rule of law and for human rights. The threats towards elected members going about their democratic duties sadly remain at both national and local level. We know that this happens to some of us in this place. Jackson Carlow mentioned the horrible event that he just recently experienced, and I want to let him know how sorry I am that he has had to experience this. We know that it has happened to others in here as well. Such threats cannot be tolerated. And even when actions do not breach the criminal threshold, they still can represent a direct challenge to the democratic process and must be vigorously opposed at every turn. We must protect our democratic processes, and the government has systems in place to seek to ensure the integrity of elections as well as the personal safety of elected members at both a national and local level. Elections, both national and local, remain safe and secure with both robust processes in place that bring together government departments, devolved administrations, local government, intelligence community and wider operational partners. During the recent election, all candidates were able to access comprehensive election security guidance, which brought together expertise from across the security community, including the police, the National Protective Security Authority, and National Cyber Security Centre, and others, to help them implement quick and effective personal protective security measures. And candidates were also able to access protective security awareness under Operation Bridger, with Police Scotland supporting any additional sessions for Scottish candidates where required. Whilst the threat towards candidates is often heightened during election periods, it does not dissipate once electors. We must remain vigilant as we represent our constituencies and promote our political campaign. So I would always encourage every member here to familiarise themselves with the protective security resources available to us both as individuals and for political parties. Presiding Officer, any democratic society must be able to operate on the basis of divergent points of view being able to be debated and exchanged vigorously, hopefully without rancour, but always free from subversion by illegitimate means. It's our collective responsibility as elected representatives, as Democrats, to ensure we strive for that end. And on that basis, I want to conclude by thanking Jackson Carlow again for raising this motion to allow us to respectfully mark the 40th anniversary of the Brighton bombing, to allow us to convey our sympathy and condolences to those directly impacted, and more widely, to enable us to reassert that political intimidation, violence and abuse have no place in our society.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting of Parliament.